Pesticides are an important part of many IPM programs. For some pest organisms, pesticides offer the most effective control. Sometimes they may be the only control available. In most situations, pesticide use is one component of an integrated program that may include biological, cultural, and mechanical pest management techniques. Properly used, pesticides can provide effective and economical protection from pests that otherwise would cause significant damage. In an IPM program, pesticides are used only when field monitoring or other site-specific information indicates they are needed to minimize economic losses. I'm Dr. DeBusk, and this video focuses on using pesticides in an IPM program. Pesticides, as defined by the Federal Insecticide, Fungicide, and Rodenticide Act, FIFRA, include any substance or mixture of substances intended for preventing, destroying, repelling, or mitigating any insects, rodents, nematodes, fungi, or weeds, or any other forms of life declared to be pests, and any substance or mixture of substances intended for use as a plant regulator, defoliant, or desiccant. Many pesticides kill pest organisms outright. Others control pests by repelling them or inhibiting reproduction or normal development. The selection and use of a pesticide can be quite complex. To control a single pest in a crop, the pest manager is expected to choose the most effective material from a list that includes as many as a dozen pesticides registered for the pest and site and that are packaged in a variety of formulations. The manager must understand how the material will react with the plant or crop, the target pests, non-target organisms, and the environment. In making the selection, hazards and risks of the material to humans and application safety must also be considered. Pesticides differ from most other pest management tools because of their potential to injure people or non-target organisms on and off the application site. When using pesticides, pest managers must first look at the pest, its life stage, and the beneficial species present. The efficacy of the pesticide in controlling the pest must be considered, as well as whether it is selective enough to allow important beneficial species to survive. The location of the application, the potential hazards, the commodity being treated, harvest timing, and cultural practices, as well as subsequent crops, must be part of the decision-making process. Finally, the philosophy of the client regarding pesticide use must be considered. The ultimate goal is to select the least toxic material that will satisfactorily and economically control the pest in the least disruptive but most effective manner possible. When making pest control recommendations, the client's philosophy regarding management of the commodity and pests is an important consideration. For instance, most growers have cost limitations that drive their pest management decisions. Some may have production contracts that put limits on the pesticides they can use, and others may wish to market their products as organic or free of pesticide residues. In urban situations, the need for pesticides varies according to landscape uses. Turf in a golf course, for instance, may require a number of herbicide applications to control invading weed species. The same weed species may be tolerated in turf in a park setting because economics, aesthetic requirements, and public concerns about herbicide use might not favor turf herbicide treatments. The suitability of the pesticide for the application site is an important consideration in the selection of the material. Prior to writing a pesticide recommendation, identify all important structures and environmental conditions on and around the application site. The location of dwellings, schools, hospitals, parks, playgrounds, commercial areas, and other places where people may work, live, or play imposes limitations that prohibit the use of certain pesticides. The location and type of adjacent crops can also be determining factors in the selection of the material. The possibility of drift and the sensitivity of an adjacent crop could eliminate certain pesticides as feasible alternatives. Non-crop areas should also be inspected. The proximity of endangered species, wildlife areas, lakes, streams, ponds, wells, and irrigation canals to the application site can influence pesticide selection if the pesticide has the potential to harm organisms in these areas. The appropriateness of the pesticide for the commodity is a primary consideration. The pesticide must be registered for use on the commodity and crop growth stage for which the application is being considered. Some herbicides, for example, can only be applied during non-bearing years, after harvest, or during dormant stages of deciduous orchards. There are many different crops with many of the same pests. Although a pesticide may be registered for one crop for use against a pest, it may not be legal to use against the same pest in another crop. Be sure to consider subsequent crops and plantback restrictions. Some pesticides leave residues that harm subsequent crops or may be illegal. Always check the label to confirm legal uses. Pesticides are available in many different formulations, including liquids, dust, granules, and baits. A pesticide formulation consists of the active ingredient, AI, that controls the target pest, and the inactive or inert ingredients added to the product. The inert ingredients dilute the pesticide, enhance its activity, or make it safer and easier to mix and apply. Some formulations are ready to use. Others must be further diluted with water or a petroleum-based solvent. When more than one formulation is available for control of a pest, consider how the formulation may affect the host plant, people, non-target organisms, and the environment. Formulations that have the longest residual activity would more likely control a larger portion of the pest population. However, these formulations tend to be more destructive to natural enemies and other non-target organisms or potentially contaminate the environment. Different formulations of the same pesticide and different types of packaging, such as water-soluble bags, also vary in cost, safety, and the type of control desired. They present different challenges for worker safety and exposure to people, livestock, and pets in the area of the application. The potential for phytotoxicity, damage to the crop plant, can be a concern with some formulations. For example, pesticides formulated with oils, such as emulsifiable concentrates, ECs, tend to cause more phytotoxicity, especially to water-stressed plants. The symptoms of phytotoxicity looks similar to abiotic disorders, disease, or insect damage. On the other hand, wettable powders are among the safest formulations to use when phytotoxicity is a concern, but the potential hazard for inhaling dust during mixing can be very high. An alternate choice would be dry flowable formulations, which, like wettable powders, are less likely to be phytotoxic, but which do not have the dust associated with wettable powders. Handling and mixing are easier because dry flowables are packaged in an easy-to-pour container and can be measured by volume as well as weight. When selecting a pesticide, drift, runoff, wind, and rainfall must be considered, along with soil type and characteristics of the surrounding area. Also, be sure that the formulation is compatible with available application equipment. Most of this information is on the label. Prior to considering the use of a pesticide, read the label. The mode of action is the mechanism by which the pesticide kills or controls the target organism. Most pesticides act by interfering with the metabolic process. Some pesticides cause physical damage to the target organism. For example, desiccants remove the waxy coating on certain insects, resulting in water loss. Generally, pesticides in the same chemical class have similar modes of action on certain types of pests. For example, all organophosphate insecticides attack the nervous system of insects. The site of action is the primary location of the enzymatic, metabolic, or physical reaction caused by the pesticide. For example, organophosphates specifically inhibit choline esterase. Knowing the mode of action will help you assess which pesticides will work best in a particular situation. It can also provide a clue as to which non-target organisms may be affected along with other pests. When trying to reduce selection for pesticide resistance, it is helpful to rotate among pesticides that have different modes of action. Different life stages of a pest commodity have different susceptibilities to pesticides due to biological and physical characteristics. Applying a pesticide at a time when the most vulnerable life stage of the pest is present increases the effectiveness of control. Persistence indicates the amount of time it takes for a pesticide to degrade. Persistence is measured in terms of half-life, the amount of time it takes for the material to be reduced to half the amount of active ingredient originally applied. The half-life of a pesticide may be affected by its chemical nature or formulation and environmental factors such as soil microbes, ultraviolet light, heat, and the pH of water used in mixing. In the chart on the slide, the half-life in the soil is relatively quick, but if it enters the groundwater, the time increases 20 to 120 times. In some situations where reinfestation is likely to occur or long-term pest control is desired, persistence may be advantageous, but prolonged persistence can also increase hazard to people, wildlife, beneficial insects, and honeybees. Highly persistent pesticides select for resistance faster. The breakdown of a pesticide does not always mean that hazards associated with it have been eliminated. Some pesticides break down into other more toxic materials. For instance, the low toxicity insecticide acephate may break down into more toxic methamidophos. Another criterion to consider in pesticide use is selectivity. the range of organisms and life stages of organisms affected by the pesticide. A broad-spectrum pesticide kills a wide range of pests and non-targets, whereas a selective pesticide controls a smaller group of closely related organisms. Selective pesticides are generally desirable in IPM programs because they often have less impact on beneficial organisms and lower risks for humans and wildlife. Selectivity that prevents damage to a crop plant is a key feature of any herbicide applied while the crop is in the field. Selective pesticides target chemical processes unique to one pest or pest group. Selectivity is also influenced by the rate of penetration of the toxicant, the binding of the toxicant to the organism's tissue, and the speed with which the organism breaks down the toxicant. Selectivity can also be achieved through the use of application techniques that cause a pesticide to come into contact with the target pests and not with non-target organisms. For example, spraying only the trunks of elm trees to control elm leaf beetle larvae as they crawl down from the tree canopy to pupate in the soil leaves the beneficial species in the foliage unharmed. Another example is the use of shields or wipers to direct herbicide applications away from susceptible plants. Toxicity is the capability of a material to cause injury to organisms. All pesticides are toxic to some organisms. Each pesticide has a toxicity rating that suggests the pesticide's relative hazard to people and other organisms in the environment. The toxic effect of pesticides in any given situation is influenced by various conditions, including temperature, humidity, and exposure to sunlight, wind, and rain. The age and general health of the pest and other organism can also influence how a pesticide affects it. For example, water-stressed weeds may tolerate some herbicides better than non-stressed weeds. Environmental factors sometimes change the chemical composition of pesticides, making them more or less toxic than the original pesticide. Some pesticides may be highly toxic to some organisms, but have low toxicity to others. The ideal pesticide would be toxic only to the target pest. Adjuvants are materials added to a pesticide formulation to enhance its performance, customize the application to site-specific needs, or compensate for local conditions. Formulation adjuvants are mixed with the pesticide active ingredient during packaging and formulation. Spray adjuvants are packaged separately from pesticides and can be added to the spray mix before application. Spray adjuvants may act in two ways: as activator adjuvants or utility adjuvants. Activator adjuvants directly enhance pesticide performance once the spray hits the plant. They include humectants, moisture retention promoters, penetrants, stickers, and wetter stickers. Utility adjuvants helps the spray application process. These adjuvants include acidifiers, buffers, colorants, defoamers, deposition aids, drift control agents, and water conditioners. A single adjuvant product can be both an activator and utility adjuvant. When recommending the addition of spray adjuvant to a pesticide formulation, become familiar with the different types of adjuvants and how they should be used. Understand the function that the adjuvant is to perform, then check the pesticide and adjuvant labels to ensure compatibility and suitability to the application site, target pests, and application equipment. The table on the slide lists various adjuvants and compares their intended effect. Surfactants are commonly added to break the surface tension on the plant leaves, allowing the pesticide to spread out. Many adjuvants function in more than one way. For instance, buffers are commonly added to lower the pH of water to enhance the effectiveness of the pesticide solution. They also retard the breakdown of the solution. In some situations, this may be desirable. In others, it may not. As with the selection of the pesticide, what occurs after the application, such as restricted entry intervals or non-target exposure, could be affected by addition of a buffer. Adjuvants are also used to reduce drift. Some also reduce volatilization, while others do not. This can be an important consideration in selection of an adjuvant. Special attention to the placement of the pesticide in the application equipment can also effectively reduce or eliminate many drift problems. In conclusion, many factors are involved in the selection of a pesticide. One must carefully select the right pesticide for the job with the least toxic effect to the environment.